the highest single death toll recorded in New York since the coronavirus outbreak began. The new urgent call for residents to stay home as officials fear the peak is still yet to come.
Plus, New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy closing parks across the state as the number of deaths continue to rise across the entire tri-state area. We'll have the most up-to-date information and tell you what you need to know.
And a weather alert. Storms moving across our area tonight, and the possibility of warmer temperatures coming our way later this week. Jack Culkin will have the latest, including your exclusive 7-day forecast.
Covering New York and the entire tri-state area, Newswatch at Noon is live right now.
New at noon, New York Governor Andrew Cuomo says 731 people have died of the coronavirus in New York within the past 24 hours. Good afternoon, I'm Cody Taylor.
And I'm Allura Leggard. Governor Cuomo just wrapped up his daily press briefing, where he just gave new alarming statistic. The death toll in New York State has hit its highest single-day increase since the outbreak began.
Over 5,000 people have died of the coronavirus in the state, with at least 138,000 people testing positive. The death toll continued to rise over the past few days, even with social distancing measures in place.
Cuomo did have some encouraging news today, though. The three-day average of hospitalizations is down, with indications that the state is reaching a plateau in the total number of hospitalizations.
Despite this, New York City still virtually shut down, with streets across the city abandoned. This morning, lights still shine bright in an empty Times Square, usually bustling with people. And last night, landmarks around the state lighting up in blue to support first responders and healthcare workers as they battle the virus on the front lines.
And hospitals overflowing with patients as ambulances line up the streets, with some hospitals even setting up makeshift tents like Mount Sinai, seen here on the Upper West Side.
Topping our headlines this afternoon, field hospitals are beginning to take shape across our area, starting with the Javits Center, which was originally supposed to take on non-COVID patients and is now treating patients that have tested positive for COVID-19. And President Trump approved the request today made by Governor Cuomo, allowing for the addition of 2,500 beds to treat COVID-positive patients. Now, this comes as the state continues to see a sharp rise in positive cases. And along with the Javits Center, the Navy Hospital Ship Comfort will also take on COVID-positive patients. Both changes come as a way to alleviate pressure for New York City hospitals and to make facilities better equipped to treat the coronavirus. And on the Upper West Side, officials have announced that the Cathedral of St. John the Divine will be converted to a coronavirus field hospital. The cathedral is expected to hold 400 beds and is set to open next week, taking on patients from nearby Mount Sinai Hospital that has seen a large influx of COVID-positive patients.
As case numbers begin to rise in New Jersey, Governor Phil Murphy announced that all state and county parks and forests were to be closed due to the coronavirus pandemic. Governor Murphy addressed that there have been group gatherings outside at parks where social distancing isn't being taken into account.
It is going to take time to reopen our state and indeed our country in a systematic and careful way to protect against a boomerang of coronavirus.
Governor Murphy stated that citizens are allowed to go outside but must do this close to home while practicing social distancing.
Yesterday, 30 healthcare workers protested outside of Harlem Hospital in Manhattan. The nurses called on officials saying they needed better support for the healthcare workers after the hospital has experienced a lack of supplies and protective gear. The nurses said that they have run out of stretchers and are understaffed, and in reply to this, New York City Health and Hospitals denied these claims and said they are hiring more clinical staff and increasing the volume of stretchers at the hospital. Protective gear is in such high demand that nurses have been turning to Amazon and spending their own money on gear.
Because we are here to protect our lives and our patients. We need to stop this pandemic. We are enraged. I'm mad right now. We are mourning our colleagues who have died already.
This protest is one of many that have occurred throughout the city over the past 2 weeks as healthcare workers are being overworked and overwhelmed by the crisis. As deaths in New York surpass 113,000, Governor Cuomo thanked both Oregon and China for sending life-saving ventilators. China donated 1,000 ventilators to New York, and they arrived at JFK Airport on April 4th, and Oregon's Governor Kate Brown gave New York an unsolicited 140 ventilators. In a speech last week, Governor Cuomo made sure to thank China. He also told Governor Brown that New York will be returning the favor in the near future. Cuomo went on to say that 66% of hospitalized patients had been discharged and that this is not over yet. The United States is in this together, and New York can still use as much help as it can get.
UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson was moved to the intensive care unit as of Monday afternoon. The decision was made by the Prime Minister's medical team when his symptoms for coronavirus worsened. As of now, Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab stated that they will continue Johnson's direction in regards to responding to the outbreak. On Tuesday, China reported that they have had no deaths due to the coronavirus outbreak for the first time since recording the virus 2 months ago. The National Health Commission stated that the country's death rate for COVID-19 has declined and has been in the single digits since March 19th. And as the lockdown in China ends, the government is still taking social distancing seriously and is urging all citizens to be careful as their lives start to go back to normal.
A critical Trump task force that was in charge of handling shipping and distributing goods was ordered to work from home after a worker from a partner company tested positive for COVID-19. The Supply Chain Resilience Task Force was located in the FEMA building in Washington, D.C. Its main focus was to find and allocate protective equipment and other materials that help to combat the spread of the virus. It is not clear yet what effect this will have on the task force's ability to find and distribute equipment, but they are still doing what they can from home. Now we're going to toss it over to our meteorologist, Jack, for a quick weather update.
Cody and Allura, we've seen temperatures today in the high 50s and lower 60s with some slight cloud coverage, but no rain has been in sight. However, we're not going to be that lucky throughout the rest of the week as we see some temperature dips and possible rainstorms coming our way. But we'll have all that and more coming up for you later on in the 7-day forecast.
Voters in Wisconsin are still heading over to the polls today, despite coronavirus concerns. We'll have the latest on the debate whether the primary should have been postponed.
And across New York City, officials are reporting an increase in hate crimes against Asian Americans. We'll have more when Newswatch at Noon returns in just a few minutes.
The coronavirus pandemic has upended the 2020 presidential election. With states like New York and Ohio postponing their primaries, it seems likely for Wisconsin to do the same. But Tuesday's primary election is on despite the state's governor issuing an executive order to postpone the elections to June 9th. The state Supreme Court overturned that decision as well as one that granted an extension for absentee voting. With voter concern around public health requests for absentee ballots increased, with people hoping to avoid the polls. Results of the primary will not be released until Monday, April 13th, a week after the primary.
Acting Navy Secretary Thomas Mobley resigned on Tuesday morning. This comes after he had made controversial remarks to the crew of the aircraft carrier USS Theodore Roosevelt about their recently fired captain. Mobley's comments stated that the captain was too naive and too stupid. Soon after Mobley submitted his resignation, Defense Secretary Mark Esper accepted his resignation on Twitter and said that Jamer McPherson was going to be his temporary replacement. Across the country, officials are reporting an increase in hate crimes against Asian Americans in response to the coronavirus outbreak. These instances are also occurring at alarming rates across the city, according to Assemblywoman Yu Lin Nui. And the Bronx police have arrested a group of teenagers for assaulting a woman on an MTA bus. And the Hate Crimes Task Force is investigating a chemical attack in Brooklyn where a 51-year-old woman was burned in her face, neck, shoulders, and back.
Celebrities are putting together a live event to celebrate healthcare workers and the UN Foundation's COVID-19 Response Fund. Curator Lady Gaga addressed to the World Health Organization that they have raised $35 million to fund the development of research, provide supplies, and testing.
Essential PPE supplies and testing kits around the world and will help improve lab capacity to rapidly process tests.
The One World Together at Home event will be broadcasted live on TV and social media on April 18th. Longtime musician John Prine died at the age of 73 due to coronavirus. The 11-time Grammy nominee was admitted into Vanderbilt University Medical Center in Nashville, Tennessee, where his family stated that he was suffering from coronavirus since late March. Prime was a favorite to musicians like Johnny Cash and Bob Dylan, and the Recording Academy stated that Prime's impact to music will inspire future musicians to come. Prime died on April 7th at 10:01 p.m.
Now, we know that universities and high schools made the switch to online classes about a month ago. But what about the students who weren't even in the U.S. until about 2 weeks ago? I spent the last few days talking to students who were studying abroad when the COVID-19 outbreak swept the world.
When the first reports of the coronavirus began spreading, Ithaca College students studying abroad, like MJ Alfonso, were not very concerned at the start.
At first, no one, at least I, didn't think that it would be as big as it was. Thought maybe it would last a week or two and kind of blow over.
That lack of concern, however, was soon replaced with much more uncertainty and fear. Take it from Olivia Inglis, who was in Sydney, Australia until as recent as March 24th.
I watched every single one of my friends, one by one, fall into like this crisis of like, I really want to stay, but I'm scared, and I'm not sure what the right thing to do is here.
It wasn't soon after that Inglis and others in Sydney realized the virus was spreading rapidly and that the danger was real.
My school closed, and within 3 days, my mom was asking me how fast I could have my things packed. By the time I had left the country, there were almost 1,000 cases, and that was 6 days.
Now, after leaving their respective countries in what seemed like a flash, students like Beau Reed are left with more questions than answers.
I was in my apartment in Italy for literally half the amount of time that I was supposed to be, so I feel like I should get some rent back, if not half.
When these students' issues will be addressed is another question in itself, only adding to the ongoing theme of uncertainty during these unprecedented times. Reporting for Newswatch, I'm Tyler Cunnington.
Another one of those questions that seems to be on the minds of Alfonso, Reed, and many others I spoke to is when they'll be able to get back belongings they left behind in their apartments. Something that, with lockdown nearly around the entire globe, doesn't seem like it'll have an answer anytime soon.
Stephanie Grisham resigned from her position as White House Press Secretary. It was announced that campaign spokeswoman Kayleigh McEnany will now be the new press secretary. McEnany was recently in the news regarding the coronavirus and her downplay of the pandemic in the United States. Grisham has now taken over as chief of staff for First Lady Melania Trump, replacing Lindsay Reynolds. Grisham announced that she will continue to be honored to serve both the president and first lady in the administration.
Joe Biden and President Trump had a phone conversation Monday afternoon regarding coronavirus aid. Trump stated that the conversation was wonderful and warm. In the call, Biden shared suggestions for actions that the administration could take to address the coronavirus pandemic. Biden also expressed his appreciation for the spirit of the American people and meeting the challenges that have come from the pandemic. Trump refused to say exactly what was said in the conversation, but he did say that he did not agree with all of Biden's suggestions. Coming up, first responders and healthcare workers uniting at one local hospital in our area. We'll show you how they are coming together during this challenging time.
And a beautiful day today, as you're seeing a live look at the Empire State Building in Lower Manhattan. Jack Culkin is next with weather.
Well, guys, we're here in the backyard where temperatures are reaching a high 50 degrees here on this Tuesday afternoon. Now, that's today's weather, but what's the rest of our week looking like? Well, let's take it on over to our 7-day forecast, where you can see Wednesday we are seeing a high of 64 and a low of 49 degrees. Thursday, April 9th, we're going to see a high of 59 degrees and a low of 43. So we can see temperatures are taking a little bit of a dip. Friday, April 10th, we see high of 49, a low of 37. Saturday, April 11th, we see a little bit of boost in temperature with a high of 56 and a low of 38. Sunday, April 12th, Easter, the big day, we see temperatures in the mid-60s with a high of 65 and a low of 56. Monday, April 13th, we see our highest recorded heat for this week at 68 degrees, 8 degrees higher than the usual for this month with a low of 46. Now it just sounds like a wonderful week coming up. We are expecting some rainfall and scattered showers throughout the week, with even the possibility of a light morning snowfall on Friday with those cooler temperatures. But don't let that stop you from getting out and enjoying the wonderful weather here. Remember to make today great and tomorrow even better. My name is Jack Culkin. Back to you in the studio.
Thanks, Jack. Several municipalities in Westchester County came together last night to support one local hospital. Phelps Memorial Hospital in Sleepy Hollow is one of the many hospitals in our area battling the coronavirus. And last night, local first responders shared their appreciation of the hospital staff. Ambulance, police cars, fire trucks, and even a helicopter fly over the flooded parking lot of the hospital, sharing a moment of solidarity with the nurses, doctors, and hospital staff. Both groups erupted in cheers outside the hospital to share a special moment together during this difficult time. And here at ICTV, we want to thank the first responders, healthcare workers, and everyone keeping us safe and informed during this time.
For the latest up-to-date information on the coronavirus in our area and across the world, head to our social media pages.
And during these challenging times, New York State has set up a COVID-19 emotional support hotline. For mental health counseling, call 1-844-863-9314.